Lime Books present Overpopulation by Robert Salisbury. Episode 1, Water Scarcity. Scene 5, Phillip's employer is dying. Banks returned to his hotel to consider how he might alleviate the problem of public unrest for Prime Minister Varinder Kirmani. He fell asleep with much on his mind, only to be awoken in the small hours by an alert from Professor Boynton Perfidius, who warned him, "He's dying! You'd better come!" The professor was physician to Lord Isaac George Martin, the man who owned the bank at which Phillip worked. Consequently, he caught the first plane back to England. 14 hours later, he drove out of London at 160 miles per hour along a rain-soaked M40, then chanced his luck along narrow winding country lanes to reach Lord Martin's home, the jewel in Buckinghamshire, Wadston Manor. He pulled up in front of its Gothic entrance, and with the engine still running and the driver's door ajar, charged into the cavernous reception hall, shoes clattering along the tiled Victorian hallways as he made his way to the library, where the professor had said he would be.
"He'll not make the night."
Knowing his employer to be 169 years of age, Banks had flung open the doors to the library, hoping to catch the Lord's last mortal utterance. What he had found was Lord Martin standing at the fireplace in dimmed light, elbow leaning on the high mantel, whiskey in one hand, cigar burning in the other.
"Ah, Phillip, who took you?"
Banks yanked at the top button and loosened his necktie. Steam escaped from his chest.
"My lord, you look remarkably well." "Don't sound so surprised."
The lord was watching homemade films on a reel-to-reel projector, which was going clickety-clickety. Black and white images danced on the wall, bashful men in hats and tails, with moustaches and waistcoats, pinched at snuff, while ladies in bell-shaped dresses, engineered with hoops, with exposed shoulders and voluminous hairdos, tittered to one another like porcelain dolls. To the modern eye, it was a mess of flawed technology, scratches and blotches and bleached-out scenes, with figures moving too quickly. For Banks, it evoked no interest. But for Lord Martin, it held magic.
"That's me,"
he cried, his eyes bulging with excitement, as a tall young figure could be seen entering the circle of men. The film ended, and a loose end of film flapped on its spindle. The house lights returned.
"Young Phillip, good to see you."
The lord held out a hand, and they executed the special handshake. The big man, 6'7", then strode across to the whiskey decanter and poured some golden spirit into a tumbler.
"Here, dark and peaty."
Banks accepted the glass and swilled some of its peppery oak liqueur over his tongue. Slight grassy overtone to the back of the throat. Working for the bank was all he had known since leaving Oxford. He had been promoted to director just recently.
"So, tell me, what is the news?"
"The Prime Minister sends his good wishes. He needs help with Red Band. There is great civil unrest."
"I see."
"They seem to be having outbreaks of malaria and dysentery, and various other nasties."
"Yes, India. A problem. Too many people."
Banks recalled the hordes in Delhi, their impoverished living conditions, and the poor water supply. But then he considered that in a world where wealth and resources were so hopelessly apportioned, population seemed irrelevant. The majority of mankind were caught in commercial slavery, and short of a paradigm shift in the structure of ownership, law, trade and education, that was not likely to change any time soon.
"What's that?"
"Oh, nothing."
"Now, I need to ask you,
What do you know about Warwink?
The Lord referred to West African Water Incorporated, a proposed conglomerate of all water supply, treatment and management infrastructure across 18 nations in West Africa. If they agreed to merge, they would become the most valuable company in the world.
I'm thinking of buying them.
Banks was used to hyperbole. He dealt with the rich, for whom reality could be stretched like chewing gum.
They are suggesting a price of $2 trillion. What say you?
Banks had read much on Warwink, as water was his market. $2 trillion, based on profits, it's worth $1 trillion at best. Would have to go into colossal debt to pay too. Not clever in these times. Stagflation, national debt, corporate bankruptcy, zombie banks.
Well?
10 years in private banking had taught him to assess risk, apply prudence, then do whatever he was told.
We would have to print money, which would flood markets and essentially devalue every major currency.
So?
We're talking $2 trillion. 2,000 billion or 2 million millions. Absolute madness.
It would have to be a very good reason for buying at these levels.
I know. It is.
Banks didn't see it. No one knows how to grow the economy anymore. It's just a chase for assets. Is this more unwinding of progress and the end of liberty for all but the billionaire class?
Lord Martin's eyebrows were dancing on their tiptoes.
Well, damn it and blast it, Phillip. What should we bid?
Things looked to be turning sour. Banks had an acuity of mind suited to these difficult judgments. I would have to spend plenty of time in Africa. A broad smile spread across his face.
High ones.
0.7, 0.8,
1.82.
Good.
Lord looked relieved. Banks had spent the last 6 years buying up water assets across Asia. This would be the largest single investment to date. 1.82 trillion. Does he know what he's doing? He doesn't look the slightest bit concerned.
I think it appropriate to break into my special reserve.
A narrow door in the wall opened. Pink light emanating from within a secret passage swallowed them both. They stepped inside. Glass cabinets displayed cigars of every size, shape, length and tone of tobacco. Maintained at 21 Celsius, with a humidity of 68.5, the shelves were organized by country of origin. Costa Rica, Colombia, Cuba, Dominican Republic, Guatemala, Honduras and Mozambique. Banks spotted a Perla del Mar Corona, a Bolivar Cebarno, and a Davidoff Cuban Special. Up and down were gems, Cohibo Esplendidos, a Camacho Candela, and a Nico Rustica El Budito. The Lord selected 2 7-inch Monte Cristo Churchills. They made their way to the smoking room and sat on leather chestertons. The Lord snipped the end of both cigars.
May I light this for you?
It was a tremendous honour. He struck a match and allowed its flame to fizzle.
Always allow the sulphur to burn off before holding it to the tip.
He slow-roasted the cigar tip with 3 matches, one at a time, rotating the cigar and blowing on it. Once an even burn had been achieved, he handed one to Banks. They drew on their cigars and blew out huge clouds of smoke. To be sharing a cigar with the owner of the bank was unheard of. Most directors at DM had never even met Lord Martin, let alone speak to him.
My lord, do you think that we might be a little long in the water?
Between ourselves and Morgan Sachs, we must own half the world's supply.
In a world of overpopulation, water is the key. They can live without cars and computers, but they can't live without water.
The Lord blew out a large cloud of smoke.
You know, I have never shared a cigar with any of my sons or grandsons or great-great-grandsons.
I'm honoured.
Come, there is no better place to enjoy a cigar than the grounds.
They made their way outdoors to the terrace, where a fresh breeze was swaying the treetops. The lord walked at a comfortable pace and seemed in rude health. The prospect of a major acquisition was on Banks's mind. As they reached the end of the hedgerow, a commanding view over the surrounding lush green farmland revealed itself.
All mine, as far as the eye can see, with the exception of a few stubborn farmers. I used to be so paranoid, so I started buying up the neighbourhood. As the years passed, I brought up almost everything. You see, Philip, patience. The key to success, patience and persistence. We didn't become wealthy by moaning about things. We were persistent. Do you have patience, Philip?
I hope so. Tell me, my lord, how does one live to such an age?
I'm getting older and older. My bones are getting colder. Just a ditty. To live a long life, you need first to want to live. I will let you in on a secret. I was born in 1826.
200? Older than he had thought.
Alas.
How? I mean, how can you live so long?
You know, Philip, all of my children and grandchildren and their great-grandchildren have long since passed. Truth is, there is no one left. No one with whom I am close. Perhaps this cigar is my only comfort.
They stepped down to a lower terrace, walking between carefully tended displays of bushes, trees and pots on marble plinths.
I was close to your father, you know. A brilliant man.
Banks had only recently discovered that his father had worked for Lord Martin. He had believed that he had been a provincial architect and not a banker. The lord paused to watch a bird high in the canopy. They stood, looking at the sky, which was thick with grey-lined cloud threatening rain. The bird cleaned its wings, then flew away.
I shall miss this place.
The professor's words replayed in Banks's head.
He'll not make the night.
The lord looked him squarely in the eye.
Now I know you are getting married, but tell me, is it enough? Or, like your father, do you love the game?
Banks drove back to London. Along the way, he called Leonie Vickers, his PA. Leonie, how is your day? I was about to call. You're booked in C22 at 1. That was quick. Henry said you'd be coming in. Henry seems to know more about me than I do. Also, Billy called. He asked if Tom Brown would be going to the basement tonight for the jazz. Billy often called him Tom Brown, due to the fact that he had gone to rugby school, where the fictional character had spent his school days. Tell him Tommy won't be going.
I didn't know you were into jazz.
There's a lot about me you don't know.
I'm willing to learn.
Scene 6. Philip Banks returns to London. Banks sat at the weekly boardroom meeting alongside a dozen or so members of the DM executive. Heading the meeting was CEO Henry Delange, a blonde-haired, pudgy, 60-something-year-old who explained that the cryptocurrency they had launched months earlier had been hacked. It had been baited with a secret back door which some of DM's own cybersecurity programmers had hacked into. A sizable amount had been stolen,
Henry explained that the culprits had been identified, and that the value of their illicit stash required 7 zeros to detail. For their perspicacity, they were promoted, put to work hacking water plants over which they had control, to test them for security. For those who had not hacked into Diem's cryptocurrency, senior management awarded a letter of commendation, appraising their honesty and integrity, followed a month later by a polite termination of contract.
Now, Billy, how is Prosuticus coming along? Fine, she's in orbit, stated Billy.
Charles William Beaumont Hunt, the second Earl of Leominster, who was a close friend of Banks and a gifted director at Delange Martin. He was also a starseed with extrasensory perception, telekinetic and other abilities.
And our pressure group? We have found a small startup in Philly. How many members? 23. What do they stand for? Quizzed Henry. They're vegans. They want to ban meat. Red meat, hence their name, Red Ban. Play on words. All right. Keep them at arm's length. Start with 1 million. That should ensure cooperation.
Henry scratched at his notebook with a fountain pen.
And what are we doing about our charismatic leader? Ubiquity are onto it, replied Billy. Marmaduke, she is already big in Asia. I'm in Milan next week. She goes global very soon.
Banks looked at Billy, as he did not know what they were talking about.
Good. That concludes.
Henry scratched some more, then closed his book and pronounced,
Meeting closed, 11:17 a.m.
He stood. Everyone stood. He left the room. Everyone relaxed. What's all this about Prosuticus and a charismatic leader?
Oh, nothing much. Can you tell Coleridge to pay payment to this startup in Philly? They only have $172 in their account. I'm sure when they see $1 million drop in, they'll be very keen to hear what we have planned for them.
Sure. What are they called?
Red Band.
Oh, that's curious. I've just discovered Red Band in India. Billy did not bite.
Must go.
Billy left. Scene 7, 22 and Spiron. Back in London, at Diem head office, Banks made his 1 p.m. appointment with 22. Having entered compliance room SO7, he was joined by 22 and his assistant, 16.
Well, well, the prodigal son returns. You have been getting around lately, haven't you?
22 fancied himself as a modern-day Isaac Newton. His accomplice 16 saw himself as Dr. Watson to 22 Sherlock Holmes. To Banks, they were more like a nerdy Batman and Robin.
Hello, Phillip, chimes 16, the younger of the two. Haven't seen you in club recently.
I've been overseas. India.
Billy has just returned from Bermuda,
replied 16, as if it were a competition. Do you know about Red Band in India?
We know everything, assured 22. Kimani needs to neutralize them.
Can you help?
They said nothing.
22 contorted his face.
Can you isolate them? Have their ringleaders arrested? Do what you normally do.
What we normally do is not what we do anymore.
Not now we have Spiron. Spiron.
22 was never happier than when he had a chance to be smug. All we need do is define Red Band and Spiron will do the rest.
How does that work?
If you were a scientist like 16 here, then I could explain it to you. But since you are not a scientist, you would not understand. Try me. Banks knew that 22 would be unable to resist the opportunity to watch him fail. If you insist, Spiron can hack any system, reprogram, override, and manipulate any outcome. You see? No, of course not. You are a director. A man of commerce, added 16. Good analogy, 16. Accepted, 22. When you have finished, you might tell me what on earth Spiron is going to do about it. When she has finished, Spiron's intellect will be beyond that of any human. Why would we tell it what to do? If we don't sort out Redband, we can't sign the deal. He's worried about his deal, 16. Tragic, 22. Spiron is programmed to identify, engage, neutralize. That is what it will do. Is there anything else? Banks looked skeptical and could think of nothing to add. He pointed at 22's crotch and added, your fly's undone. 22 looked down and Banks headed for the door.
Later!
He exited the office. Scene 8. I'm under orders. Banks pictured his fiancée at home preparing for their guests. He knew the meticulous attention she would have brought to the task. Zara was a perfectionist. He called her. Hi. What is it? She was multitasking. I have bad news. Don't tell me you will be late tonight.
Worse. I won't be coming home.
What?
I have to catch a flight back to India. Straight away, I'm afraid.
But I have arranged for Simon and Delilah to come over. I've cooked salmon, your favourite.
I'm sorry. I'm heading for Heathrow now, on a flight in 2 hours. Have to get back to Delhi for tomorrow.
What is it? You sound strange. Is there a problem?
Yes, of course there's a problem.
I mean something serious.
He blew out a lungful of air. Could not answer. In truth, he did not want to go back to Delhi. He had no idea what he would do. I'm under orders.
Orders?
It doesn't matter.
It does. Why can't you take a day off? You've been away for nearly a week. Can't you delay? Just tell them morning. Catch an early flight. I'll run you to Heathrow in the morning.
I can't. I have to go. I'm sorry, darling.
You'll miss me.
Okay, I'm going now.
Will you miss me?
Hey, don't tempt me. I'm doing this for us.
Are you sure?
Of course. You think I want to go back to Delhi with this pressure over me?
What am I going to say to Simone and Delilah?
You'll think of something.
Maybe I'll get them to call you.
No, don't.
I love you.
Bye.
Bye, Philip. Take care. Call me when you land.
Scene 9. A death blow. Banks landed in Delhi early local time. The heat of Delhi hit him as he left the plane. In the dry air, and with the whistle of engines from planes taxiing down the runway, Banks made a call to Raja P. Thakula of Thakula Construction. He needed to see if he could leverage anything off his company.
Roger, it's Philip Banks calling. I'm back in Delhi. Can we meet?
Raja delivered bad news. His company had been approached by DFL Construction and offered a better deal if they supported the Indian tender. It was a death blow. Banks was too winded to think of anything to counteroffer and hung up on a promise to come back later that day. So now, he had no construction workers. His ability to construct the pipework necessary was blocked by his main rival, and he was under a deadline of 1 week to deliver. Leone had booked him into the Lea Palace Hotel, which was set within the diplomatic enclave of New Delhi. It had the benefit of a Rolls-Royce pickup service from the airport. So Banks sat in the back of the Rolls and drank champagne, as it was the only drink in the car. While he drank, hoping his luck might change, he called the number he had been given for the Prime Minister's office. It connected through to a man who answered in Hindi, but who quickly switched to English. He was informed in perfect RP that the PM was out, so he left a message. At the Lear Palace Hotel, he took a shower, then changed, and visited the rooftop pool. The outdoor swimming pool, in the heat of midday, was gloriously refreshing. Beneath him, in all directions, the wonder of this ancient city could be seen, but in better proportions, unlike from the helicopter. He could now see people walking, driving cars, the industriousness of the people of Delhi in action. Having relaxed in the pool, he headed downstairs to the spa centre for a massage. While he lay face down on the table with a towel around his waist, a lady with very firm fingers pushed and kneaded the muscles around his back and shoulders. After 30 minutes, he felt much lighter. He returned to his room to check the news. A red band protest was making headlines. Thousands had occupied the site of the Taj Mahal. Banks needed a plan. Since he had no idea what, if anything, Spiron would do to help, he needed to take action. He dressed in a light oatmeal suit with pristine white open-neck shirt and headed to reception. He called his driver Jason and waited in the bar. By the time of his arrival, the sun was falling in the sky and Banks had already had a few shots. They drove out from the hotel and onto the main road.
"Where would you like me to take you, sir?"
"Jason, who do you know who is part of Red Band?"
"Red Band, sir? I'm sorry, sir, I am not knowing them."
Banks proffered a $100 note for the driver to take.
"Please, sir, what are you doing?"
"Who do you know who is Red Band?"
"I'm sorry, sir, don't know anyone, sir."
Banks added another $100 note to his offering. "Take me to them."
"Please, don't be embarrassing me, sir, but I am not knowing anyone from Red Band."
Banks took another $300 from his wallet and held out them before the driver. $500. "And 500 more if you can take me to them." Jason looked at the notes, then slowly took them from Banks' hand.
"I will try."
30 minutes later, Banks sat alone in a downmarket restaurant with a mango lassi. He had been told to wait. Someone would join him. Jason had emphasized that he could make no guarantees. The restaurant was busy with locals. Its front windows were open to the elements, and the interior was hot. A single, lazy ceiling fan dispersed the flies in the heat. Banks removed his jacket and rolled up the arms to his shirt. He enjoyed the sweetness of his drink whilst updating on news. Clashes between police and Red Band were being reported in several cities. Red Band were demanding free health care for the poor. The big cities were afflicted by high levels of malaria and fever. It was India's main news item. Two men entered the restaurant and glanced over at Banks. One sat by himself, leaving the other to approach alone.
"Mr. Banks, may I join you?"
"Certainly." The man turned the chair around and sat facing its back. He was young, perhaps 20, with a distinctive red silk sash tied discreetly through the hoop of his waist belt.
"What is your purpose?"
Banks interlocked his fingers and made an A-frame of his arms on which to rest his chin. He stared at the young man for a moment. The young man grew impatient.
"Who are you?" he asked whilst chewing gum.
"Unimportant."
"You asked to meet. What do you want?"
"You are Red Band, right?"
Yes.
You have demands.
Our people are suffering. Poor housing, poor conditions, malaria, lack of sanitation. They cannot afford health care, like the rich, who live in hotels and travel and enjoy the fruits of India.
Doesn't the government do anything for you?
They don't care.
What if I could get you a meeting with the Prime Minister to hear your case? The young man recoiled incredulously, then looked back at his entourage.
You could do that.
I could. The young man stood and rotated his chair to the correct way around, then sat down again.
You want a drink?
I've had this. He raised his lassi.
Some food, perhaps?
No.
English?
Yes.
MI5?
No. The young man had a tattoo on the side of his neck, just beneath his ear. He had presence. Banks labelled him an idealist.
I am not the leader of Red Band.
There is no leader.
I know.
How close can you get me to the Prime Minister?
Close enough.
What do you want?
I want you to do me a favour.
What is it? Banks asked Jason to drop him at his hotel. That night, Banks searched for all he could on Red Band. They were in evidence on three continents and clearly growing. He made another call to the Prime Minister's office and left a message. Then he changed and went down to the bar to listen to live music. A pianist was playing classics from the American songbook. Before retiring, he contacted Zara, who was counting RSVPs for their wedding. He called Billy next to update, and finally he contacted 22.
Philip, you need to leave Delhi the day after tomorrow, by 10 p.m.
Why?
Just leave.
All right. The following morning, Banks swam in the rooftop swimming pool, then took tea in his room whilst checking up on the news. Once again, the biggest pre-election news was about Red Band. The Prime Minister was on most channels, priming his forthcoming public address to the people, which he would deliver from outside the Astrakhan Temple the day after tomorrow, and coinciding with the evening news. From his hotel room, he called 22.
You said Spiron can hack any system?
It can. Get me access to the Prime Minister's official list for tomorrow's entourage. He is giving a speech outside the Astrakhan Temple at 5 p.m. There's bound to be a list of journalists in close protection.
Child's play.
Really? I'm on my mobile. Can you let me know when you've done it, please?
It's done already, replied 22 flatly.
What do you mean already?
I just did it.
Like that.
It runs at the speed of light.
You see what happens is, and Banks left his device on loudspeaker and went for a shower.
Philip, are you there?
Scene 10. The President's Speech. The next morning, Banks had already had his rooftop swim and followed up with a massage in the health spa. He felt much lighter. He dressed in a light oatmeal suit, open-neck shirt, then headed out for the temple. The day was very hot, and he was left his car, he instantly felt his limbs cook. Thousands of protesters wearing the Red Band scarf lined the area, cordoned off by security, presumably where the Prime Minister was to appear. Banks approached security and asked if he could gain access.
My name is Phillip Banks. I'm here to see Prime Minister Virinder Kimani. Please check.
Security looked at him suspiciously. They blocked his way and relayed orders to others behind them. With each minute, the sweat on Banks's back increased, until his shirt was caked wet to his skin. The air temperature was in the high 40s, and there was little if no breeze. The man returned in a hurry and pushed aside the other guards.
Come through, Mr. Banks, this way, sir.
They rushed him through the open gardens in front of the Astrakhan temple and into a crowded and heavily air-conditioned portable office in the gardens. The time was 4:53 p.m. and Verinda Kiramani was sat in a chair looking at notes whilst two women fixed up his hair and makeup. Security introduced him.
A Mr. Phillip Banks from Delange Martin to see you, Prime Minister.
The PM withdrew a few steps, allowing Banks to approach the PM.
Mr. Banks, you return. As you can see, I am being a little busy at present. For my campaign manager's stress levels, I am to make a major speech, which he is hoping will seal my return to the palace.
I have begun plans to deal with your problem.
You make it sound so personal. But, as you can see outside, there is the largest gathering of Red Band ever. Too bad, Mr. Banks. While Red Band menace my campaign, your water project will remain in the hands of Indian contractors. We are not indebted to the British anymore.
Banks felt desperate. He had believed that the Prime Minister was sympathetic to his case, it being both more economical and able to execute over a shorter time span than that of his rival Indian company. But now it appeared that the nationalism was also against him, and he had only a week left.
Help yourself to a drink. Join the journalists. Do stay around for my speech. But as you can see, I am rather busy.
Banks withdrew to the far side of the room and took a glass of sparkling water from the table, which was laden with non-alcoholic drinks. With a few minutes to broadcast, the PM and a small entourage left the room and walked out into the heat of the afternoon. Banks put down his water and followed them. The PM climbed a makeshift platform and approached the microphone. Beneath him, the world's media had an impressive shot of the gardens either side of and the temple behind him. The sky was a magnificent orange, which created the kind of serenity and peace that only India can. His director counted him in, and on the hour, Verinda Kirmani addressed the world's largest democracy electorate.
My fellow Indians,
he spoke in English too. As he began, a loud jeer from the hundreds of thousands of Red Band protesters drowned out his voice. The PM was pro and continued, knowing that his microphone would attenuate extraneous noise. For those present, all one could hear were chants and roars, which became louder and louder, until, like the bursting of a dam, a mass of Red Band members broke through security and rushed for the Prime Minister. Through sheer weight of numbers, they trampled and crushed the cameramen and press and made their way for the rostrum. Close protection agents rushed the PM. Banks was standing next to the door to the temporary office. As it was the only place to hide, he dived indoors. Following him, two security burst in with the Prime Minister in their grip. Once inside, they locked the door shut and huddled around the PM like worker bees securing their queen. The office began to boom with 100 beats as members of Red Band attacked the metal walls. Inside, Banks stood still listening to the beats on the wall until they stopped. He guessed security had cleared the protesters. In a sudden movement, one of the security stood back from the other and pulled a gun from beneath his vest. A red scarf was wrapped around it. He pointed it at the PM. The other guard stood between them. No one moved. The Prime Minister looked terrified. Banks had a side view of the Red Band pointing his gun at the Prime Minister, who was one man between a bullet and certain death. The gunman screamed out something in Hindi, then squeezed the trigger. The gun clicked, but it failed to fire. Banks rushed forward, driving the assassin into the wall. Banks Banks sprawled on top of him, just as his second shot attempt proved successful. The second shot caught the security man in the chest. At such close range, the bullet meant certain death. He fell to the floor, leaving the Prime Minister totally exposed. In the struggle, the gun came loose and span across the floor. The assassin attempted to crawl over the floor to reach it, but Banks grabbed his ankle and yanked him backwards. Banks' hand scraped against the sole of the assassin's shoe as he kicked and tussled to get free, but Banks did not let go, lest the killer reach the gun. With both hands, he hauled the assassin to himself. Then, whilst taking a severe kicking, he rose up and headbutted him. It dazed the man, but in his heightened panic, he managed to break free and ran for the door. He unlocked it and exited. The PM looked deep into the eyes of Banks. Between them lay the gun. The door slammed shut, and they both knew that the assassin was escaping. Banks pounced on the gun and got to his feet. He yanked the door wide open and looked across the sea of red band. There were hundreds of thousands, with security attempting to keep them back. Banks noticed a figure running at speed. He raised the pistol above his head. Then, in a gentle arc, he brought it down to his eyeline until the assassin was in front of his barrel. Security was shouting at him. Whether it was because they were shouting in Hindi, or whether it was because he was in the zone, Banks did not register them. The Prime Minister looked on, transfixed. Banks narrowed his eyes and waited for a clear shot. Being so far away, the size of an insect, meant that hitting the target would be entirely luck. The assassin stopped and turned to look back. Banks settled his system until not even his pulse could disturb him from maintaining line of fire. He squeezed the trigger. The bullet left his pistol at the speed of sound. No sooner detonated from the barrel than it had whisked past everyone and exploded in the assassin's chest. The tiny figure leapt backwards and landed in a dead heap on his back. Banks brought the gun down to his side and felt suddenly overwhelmed with exhaustion. He laid the gun on the floor. The Prime Minister laid a hand on his back. "I owe you my life." He was moved. Having cleared his name, the Prime Minister looked him in the eye. They had shared something terrible and did not need words to feel the bond forged between them. "I will award the contract to you. It is the least I can do." "Thank you, Prime Minister. Call me Verinda, please." "I just came to tell you that I have arranged for you to meet with the leader of Red Band. Help you negotiate some peace. The rest will be down to you." The PM looked shocked. "Who are you, Phillip Banks?" "I work for Delange Martin. We are advisors to the Reserve Bank of India, Prime Minister." "Oh." As soon as he had left the scene, Banks met up with Jason and the two men from Red Band.
"Apologies for kicking your hand. I was very nervous, sir."
"That's all right. You were very convincing. And your colleague managed to get away, I see." Spiron had given them both identities and member passes, so that, with the right uniform, they could play the role of security for the Prime Minister. Both were unharmed and agreed to inform the relevant leader of a meeting with the Prime Minister of India. Banks phoned head office and asked to speak with Lord Martin.
"Well?"
"H2 Envirocon have been awarded the Delhi Basin Water Infrastructure Project, sir."
"Is it signed?"
"By Verinda Kermani, the PM himself, my lord."
"How on earth did you manage that?"
"I gave it a shot."
"Well done.
Come and see me on your return.
Lord Martin hung up. Phew. Banks was exhausted.
Having checked out of his hotel and headed for the airport in the back of his complimentary Rolls-Royce, he contacted Zara.
Hi.
Phillip, where are you?
I'm on my way home.
Did you sort things out?
Yes.
Could you meet me at Heathrow? I'll be coming in on BA142 at 7:20 tomorrow morning.
Okay.
I saw your hotel online. It looks like you've been having a good time.
Banks remained silent.
Did you try their pool?
He was still thinking.
Phillip?
Miss you.
What?
See you tomorrow.
He hung up.
Whilst contemplating his return flight, he received a call from 22.
Have you left Delhi yet?
I'm on my way to the airport.
What time is your flight?
9:40 p.m.
As soon as you take off, send me a message.
Okay.
Banks was puzzled.
Scene 11. Balloons and Biocide. As Banks sat aboard his flight back to London, high above Delhi, a fleet of planes were on the move, the first of which opened its undercarriage, and men aboard pushed out large balloons. They distorted severely as they left the plane and caught the air. Each plane dispatched three large balloons. Once executed, a message was confirmed to the head pilot, who relayed the message to 22 in London. The balloons drifted through the black night, their cover tearing as they picked up speed. As they ripped apart, hundreds of smaller balloons were released, which dispersed over a wide area, encompassing the grounds of the Ashtakam temple. As they descended to 1,000 meters, air pressure burst each balloon, releasing more than 1 billion mosquitoes into the atmosphere. They fell in a fuzzy cloud, invisible to the night, scattering across the city, landing on cars, buildings, homes, offices, trees, roads, and people, red band alike, each one infected with Professor Boynton Perfidius's deadly concoction. Banks sat back in his seat, shoes off, his father's book, The Final Solution, in hand. It was a long flight, 11 hours. He sipped on his whiskey, opened the book at page 1, and began to read. Scene 12. Flashback. Ceremony 1978. Dinner plates were being scraped and loaded into giant washing machines. Chefs busied themselves cleaning the kitchens for the next banquet. Outside in the halls, old alliances had been reacquainted. Leaders kissed hands, sworn enemies signed treaties, and posed for the record. Those normally at each other's throats now sang the praise of their enemies with grand eloquence. They would soon depart and hate once more. Once the shadows and senior members of the guard had disappeared, the real business of administering the planet could begin. Trusted bureaucrats from the intelligentsia, academia, banking, law, science, military, and politics would begin their download and wait to find out if anything remarkable had been discovered. If it had, the shadows would already know. The meeting began with an overview of the global economic situation. USA and European inflation was problematic. Growth was sluggish. The UK was dogged by strikes. China, following the death of Chairman Mao, had signed up to terms with the shadows, who were investing in China's manufacturing sector. Japan had signed a trading alliance with Europe and USA, the Trilateral Commission. It was good news for Lord Martin, as Delonge Martin were the major shareholders in the Bank of Japan, which issued Japanese national currency. The Grand Hall was arranged with round tables, seating 8, fronted by a raised podium with screen for guest speakers. First up was a surgeon who had recently delivered the world's first baby using vitro fertilization, IVF, Lewis Joy Brown. She was followed by a mathematician who explained Apple's new operating system, DOS 3.1, followed by their new 5.25 floppy diskette drive. Things lightened with the arrival of a blonde-haired politician who compared managing the national economy to the weekly shopping bill. She scored a ripple of laughter for stating that,
"If you want things said in Parliament, ask a man. If you want things done, ask a woman."
Her performance sealed her future as Britain's first female Prime Minister. Master of House, Sir Pell Hallett-Shoebridge, stepped up to announce the next guest speaker.
"Your Royal Highnesses, Lords, Ladies and Gentlemen, distinguished guests, may I introduce Nobel Prize-winning biologist, Fellow of the Institute of Diseases and Viral Technologies, and Cambridge Scholar of Anthropology, Professor Boynton Perfidius." Polite applause followed as the professor was well known as Lord Martin's physician. Like most present, he was also a celebrity, yet unknown to the public. Fiddling clumsy in the pocket of his tweed jacket, he climbed the stage with the uneasy grace of an academic. A tall, slim man with a typically Norman frame, his upper body rocked from side to side as he progressed on spindly legs. From behind the lectern, he fed the spring-loaded arms to his glasses around the back of his ears, then stood to full height to inspect those gathered.
"In Shakespeare's time,"
his voice boomed across the hall. He paused to scratch at the fluffy mess of grey hair that bordered his bald head.
"In Shakespeare's time, the population of the world was 500 million. It did not reach 1 billion until 1804. Then took 132 years to climb to 2 billion, and 37 more to reach 3. Today, the world is 4.6 billion and expected to climb to 5 by 1990.
There was a murmur of concern from guests. The professor continued.
"If we do not contain our population, nature shall do it for us."
Above the chatter, Countess Heinz Berghofen called out,
War will save us!"
The idea caused uproar, and the descent of ringing of wine glasses being tapped lightly by a fork, which was form for the ascensions deemed unworthy.
"Not so," assured the professor, bringing the room to silence. "The deaths from 10 years of World War I and II number just 126 million.
The professor stated that population growth was running at 1 billion per decade.
"Even if we wage continuous world war, we will still gain 800 million more people each decade. War simply does not kill enough people."
The room fell silent. It was suggested that if infant mortality could be reduced in the third world, that families might be encouraged to have less children. China's one-child policy was applauded,
as was sterilization of the lower caste members of the Indian continent through the guise of vaccination.
There is little point in those who cannot afford to feed themselves in having children.
This time, a round of ringing glasses chorused with approval. Education for women was felt to be the best route for reducing the birth rate in the West. Further still, working women would be less likely to have children, especially as they would be low paid. This additional source of low wage earners would also be of benefit to commerce. A large picture of a beehive appeared above the professor.
When we reduce the hive, if we do not target, we risk losing the queen. This, then, is one of our main problems. Targeting.
The beehive changed to a picture of a chimpanzee.
We have, through zoonosis, transferred the simian immunodeficiency virus from chimpanzees to humans. I give you GRIDS. Gay-related immune deficiency.
A photo of the village people appeared on the screen.
This will form our first experiment in targeting specific clusters of people within a community. We have run virus testing in the Congo, and I am excited to say we have also launched a limited infection in San Francisco.
The room fell silent.
Did you say gay?
Yes.
The virus will only attack practicing homosexuals.
To what end?
Well, ultimately, it will cause termination.
The questions came thick and fast. What are the symptoms? How many are affected?
Please, please, do not be alarmed. Everything is under control.
Which pharmaceutical companies are backing it? Is the government involved? Can heterosexuals catch it?
No, it is exclusively for, or should I say, prevalent to, homosexuals.
Do you have the antidote?
We are only infecting 8 practicing homosexuals who will keep a close eye on them. There is absolutely no possibility of an outbreak.
You have been listening to Overpopulation, the Hidden Agenda for Global Reset. Book 3 in the Phillip Banks trilogy by Robert Salisbury.